Welcome to The Long Way Around. I'm your host, Malcolm Byrne, here on Radio Kingston. And as always, thank you, Tjokesson. It was a special show with One Way Sky, great new up-and-coming band, going to the top of the toppermost, I'm sure. Fantastic group of young, hot-blooded young fellows on their way to stardom, I'm sure. Well, let's see. It's a beautiful day out there in the neighborhood, as Mr. Rogers used to say. And tonight I have a very special guest, Mr. Adolf Reed Jr. And I'm going to just read a little bit of an introduction here. Adolf L. Reed Jr. is professor emeritus of political science at the University of Pennsylvania. He's held positions at Yale, Northwestern, and the New School. Reed's scholarship has focused on race, American politics, and inequality. He's a contributing editor to The New Republic and has been a frequent contributor to Harper's Magazine, The Nation, and Jacobin. And I'd also like to read, if you don't mind, Adolf, some of the liner notes from your newest book, The South, Jim Crow and Its Afterlives, which is published on Verso Press, I think. And Henry Louis Gates Jr., Harvard University, writes, Adolf L. Reed Jr.'s work has long been characterized by its sharp, incisive analysis, counterintuitive insights, and wit. In the spirit of John Toomer's Cain, Reed vividly captures the essence of a signal aspect of the African-American tradition, a world known as the Black Belt, a world that is passing, a world in its final phase of transition, one that all too soon will vanish. This riveting book is essential reading for anyone seeking to understand how the forces that shaped our complex racial past persist in shaping and obscuring our racial present. Welcome to the show, Adolf. Good to see you.
Oh, Malcolm, thanks for having me, man. That's I'm quite happy to be here.
And
I'm glad they got the book to you, apparently.
Yeah, I managed to get about halfway through it. So I can't quite quote liberally from the entire book, but it's been engaging, to say the least.
Good.
And I've also been a fan of yours for quite some time. You know, I've heard your talks that seem to pop up quite regularly on various websites and YouTube channels like Jacobin and so forth. And as coincidence would have it, a couple of months ago, I was down in New Orleans. Our mutually shared stomping grounds. I lived there for about 12 years, and I ran into at a memorial service your nephew Michael Francis.
So this is cousin. Yeah, my first cousin.
Cousin,
yeah.
Sorry.
So
special shout out to Michael Francis.
Yeah, absolutely.
For making the hookup. So,
yeah.
Welcome to the show.
Again. I mean, thanks for having me. I'm glad to be here.
Yeah, and. As I said, you know, as Liz Hill, our wonderful producer, probably explained in her initial email, you know, this show is primarily a music program. Mm-hmm. It started out, it's genetic originally was when they asked me to do this show. They said, what would you like to do? And I said, well, as long as I can do anything, I'll do anything I want as long as it's just music. But things have kind of mutated. And I've started having guests on, and I thought it's an interesting way of combining, you know, interesting conversation, intellectual pursuits with music at the same time, just to kind of keep things interesting.
Oh. Well, in fact, I mean, I really like that idea of, you might even come up with a playlist.
Well, you did a great job. I'm excited to play some of these tracks, and I stuck a few on the end there just in case we ran out of time with your playlist.
Okay, good.
Some Johnny Adams and Ernie K. Doe.
Oh, man, look. I mean, Johnny Adams was a friend of mine, actually.
Oh, really?
Yeah, and we were from the same neighborhood. And I would, like, I drove once from New Haven to Providence to see him play. And I would see him every time I was in the city. And after he... I was honored after he got that cancer diagnosis. They had a benefit for him at Tipitina's, which I just happened to be in town. I went to, and when he saw me, he had me come up Well, let's sit upstairs, him and the family. But yeah, I love that guy. I love his music. And frankly, I almost put 4 or 5 pieces by him on the playlist, but I've run out of space already.
Well,
that's great. That's perfect.
Yeah, if we have time.
And, and also Cato. So
yeah, Ernie, he was a trip. You ever go to Ernie Cato's mother-in-law's lounge?
Oh yeah. In fact, I was there. Some friends. I guess it must have been right before the pandemic or right after the pandemic. Kermit Ruffins runs it now, but actually, my cousin Michael and I went to DBA when I was last in the city, and he's close to brother Tyrone, who was sitting in with Walter Washington's band because Walter had been ill. And we're back in the break room, right, with Tyrone and Everett, the guitarist, who was also Michael's neighbor. And Johnny Adams came up, and Tyrone got almost misty-eyed, and he said, you know, he recalled the first time he actually saw him. He was in some club and was sitting with Cato. And Tyrone said he went up, you know, to Johnny and shook his hand and talked about how happy he was to meet him. He was like a hero to him. And he said, Cato turned to him and said, what the hell am I? Well, but I'm a star too, you know. And I thought, man, that's classic Ernie Cato. When I was in high school, Cato had a basketball team that he sponsored in the Y League. And he was such a ball hog, his own team kicked him off, right? Like, he's a point guard who would bring the ball across half court and, like, launch it, right? but at the circle at midcourt, he was so confident in his abilities. But, yeah, that's Ernie Cato.
How long did you live in New Orleans for?
All through high school, and then a year in college.
Because you really talk about that quite a bit in the book, at least.
Yeah, I mean, I was there. Yeah, I was there every summer of my life, practically. And I think I may have mentioned this in the book. You know, expatriate New Orleanians, and that's often how they think of themselves, tend to live like expatriates, right? So I was kind of raised as an expatriate. I'm a New Orleanian, no matter where I was.
I moved there when I was 28, I think. I went down there to work with the Neville brothers.
Oh, wow. Yeah, yeah, okay.
Couple of other Canadian guys, and I made a few records with them. And, you know, I just ended up there I've got blood down there now. My daughter lives there. And,
oh, wow. Okay.
So I still have, you know, I still feel this. I have that same feeling about the place, you know. Whenever I go back, I'm like, oh, yeah, I'm home now.
No, totally. And I don't know about you, man, but like when I get off the plane and I hear the accent, I say, oh, yeah, okay, I'm here. Right.
It's when I hear the accents, because there are many, and also that's certain smell.
Right. Oh, yeah, that's right.
You know, there's that. I don't know how to describe that smell, but it's
it's not a
bad smell. Yeah. It's
no,
it smells like New Orleans. No.
There's that moisture in the air, right, always too. That's part of it, I think.
Except in those days, because I used to live in the Bywater neighborhood, Ninth Ward area, and from where I lived, you could see, you know, the river bend. There's the oil refineries down there in Chalmette.
Oh, yeah. So
now and then the breeze would be going this way, and you get that invigorating odor of oil burn off.
Oh, man, yeah. Oh, Lord, I know.
But anyway, yeah, it's a good place. But you also have, I want to plug your book a little bit because it's about six months old. Come out, but it's really an interesting. It's not really an autobiography, though, is it?
No,
it's. I mean, you use anecdotes in the book. I mean, my favorite so far. My favorite is the when you're going across the Mississippi over to Algiers on the ferry.
Oh yeah.
And there was chicken wire on the ferry. And will you tell the story?
So I always loved. So that was in the years when I lived outside the South. When I was a small kid. And when I would go down there, you know, I would have to get reacquainted with the rules and racial etiquette.
I mean, and this is during. Sorry to interrupt you, but to qualify this for people who may not be entirely familiar, we're talking about the era of Jim Crow.
Right. Oh, yeah, that's right. Yeah, you know, this was the 1950s, and I was a little kid. Right. I was born in 1947, and it was tough for me to get straight because as a 5-6-year-old, you don't quite understand, what the reason for the rules is. So I loved to ride the ferry across, to Algiers and back. And my grandmother and I would often do it. And it's one time, we were sitting close to the middle of the passenger area. And I noticed that there was a chicken wire barrier that separated the two sides of the seating area. So I asked my grandmother what that was about, because it didn't make sense to me. And she said, kind of in a stage whisper, well, a lot of crazy people ride the ferry, and the crazy people have to sit on the other side of the chicken wire. So that made sense to me at the time. But I mentioned that in another interview a few months ago, and somebody asked me if it had registered with me that the people on the other side of the wire were all white. And when I think back on it, I realize, no, it didn't register to me then, right? So my grandmother said they were a bunch of crazy people. And I mean, to that point, I'd lived all my life in either New York City or D.C., so there was a potpourri of people from all over the world out walking about all day and night. So it's the biggest cliche in the world, but what I would later understand to be race, 4 or 5, 6-year-old kid, you don't know what that is, unless you have a reason to know what it is, right? And I mean, down there, you had a reason to know.
Yeah.
Right? Even though it's hard to figure out, you had a reason to know.
And it's, the other thing, I mean, this book is a little bit of a departure from your previous writings. I mean, in the sense that it's more, as I say, it's got a lot of these anecdotal, it's like the experience of, I don't think people can even imagine, what Jim Crow, what that would really mean. Like when you talk in the book about, there'd be one store where you could, you'd be treated a certain way when you're buying a hat.
Right.
So you go to that store because you'd be treated okay. Right. But then another store where you'd be treated better for buying shoes. And you had to work out this whole sort of almost like a weird board game or something with bizarre rules that just keep getting changed all the time or something.
That's a good comparison. Yeah, and I mean, that's exactly what prompted me to write the book. I mean, I may say this in the intro, but a couple of friends of mine, good friends of mine, one of my closest friends. One's 7 years older than I am. One's 10 years younger. They both have roots in that region. And beginning by the late 90s, we just started observing and chatting back and forth with one another, that when our rough age cohort leaves the stage of history, as it were, there won't be anybody else around with any sort of living connection to that era. And what that means is that what it was like, right, and how that social order was reproduced on a daily basis, mm-hmm. through people's actions and accommodations, and how people navigated it, right, both black and white, to maintain dignity or a sense of decency or will be totally unknown. And, this book isn't a corrective by any means. And I, try to convey and to be, and even more than convey, to be constrained by the partiality and idiosyncratic character of my own experience. So the book should not be read as this is how it really was kind of thing. But really more to give a sense of the texture of what it was like to try to have a normal life, right? When under that regime. And it's also important, and I'm pretty sure I make this point in the book, and in writing it in the book, I found myself saying it in more and more context too, that we tend to think of the white supremacist order as having been imposed by white people on black people. But that's not what happened, right? It was imposed by some white people on everybody else, right? I mean, black people like in other whites too. It's not like white people got together, you know, and had a, you know, I don't know, a wiener roast and made a determination that they were all going to do this thing, right? So I mean, like, for instance, I'm trying to remember the year, the state of Louisiana passed a separate or a streetcar segregation ordinance, I think maybe 1902 or something like that. The rail car law was passed in 1892, the one that Plessy challenged. And there was a lot of opposition in the city of New Orleans from both blacks and whites to imposing Jim Crow in a streetcar. It's not, right? I mean, not because it was a locus of the interracial brotherhood and everybody wanted to sit together and sing Kumbaya, but it just seemed like an unnecessary inconvenience that everybody had to adjust to. And of course, the streetcar companies also opposed it, right? Just as the rail companies had opposed the rail segregation law. But it's like that. It's not like, you know, white people were, look, actually in 1983, I was at an event in Amherst, Massachusetts, on the campus of Hampshire College, where I heard a black woman say that that the experience of black staff, right, at the universities was that they'd go into their offices and just be hated all day long, like all their white coworkers had to do with themselves, they had to think about, was hating them, right? Mm-hmm. Well, it's not like they had to, mortgages that they had to meet, or, you know, medical bills they had to pay, right? I mean, so what happened with the book was I just started writing around 2002 or three, right before I went to Penn, right? I know. And I started writing with no particular end in mind, no objective. I didn't know whether it was going to be an article or a book or what. And I pretty quickly wrote myself into that no person's land of 15,000 words, right? Too long for an article, too short for a book. And it just sat on my computer and languished. I made a couple of attempts. Like, I didn't think, so like initially I thought that what I might do would be, since this account of the what you might think of as the second half of the Jim Crow era is kind of propelled by vignettes from my own experience, I thought I might go back and then write the first half propelled by vignettes from older family members' experience. Mm-hmm. But I never got around to doing that, and I guess I felt on some level like it wouldn't have the same kind of, pardon me, ring of truth to it. So yeah, I mean, and eventually I mentioned to my colleague Barbara Fields, a historian at Columbia. We were on a panel together at the Southern History Association meeting that I had written this thing, and it was just kind of stuck there. And she actually started prodding me. Like first she asked to read it, she read it, and then she started prodding me to get it published, and you know, that's what happened. Well, and also, as luck also had, the editor at Verso, I figured something was up, but when I saw his name, and he actually lives not that far from you, I forget the town he's in, but his surname has a Dupuy in it, D-U-P-U-Y, and that's a very distinctive name, South Louisiana. Turns out his mother is from New Orleans, and he grew up in and out of the city a lot too. So he liked the book, and in fact, his wife, who also works at Verso, who did the Jackman interview with me, told me that that she liked the Algiers fairy story, partly because Asher's mother lives in Algiers, and their child also likes to ride the ferry back and forth.
We should probably just go to a little break, just play some things, and then when we come back, we'll maybe segue into some music.
Okay, excellent. Sounds great.
So we'll be right back. Stay tuned.
Hi, this is Callie McKenzie. I'm the host of Night Rise.
Hi, I'm Kristen from Radio Kingston.
Hey, it's Chris Wells with The Art Life. Pride's important. Why? LGBTQ rights are being threatened even today in 2022. That's one reason. Personally, it took me a long time to feel pride around my sexuality. And now I do. I wish that for everyone.
Pride Month is important to me because the first Pride Parade was on the one-year anniversary of the Stonewall Riots. And not only was it a celebration of being unapologetically who we are, but also told all us queer folks that sometimes you've got to put a brick through a window to get your rights. I carry that with me every day.
That no matter how I identify, and however and whomever I love, I have a right to those feelings and to be accepted for who I am. I mean, isn't that what we all want? Happy Pride Month from Radio Kingston.
Happy Pride from me and Radio Kingston.
Happy Pride Month from Radio Kingston.
Hi, this is Laura from the Kingston Farmers Market. You can find us every Saturday from 9 a.m. to 2 p.m. uptown in the County Courthouse parking lot with entrances on John and Wall Streets. We have over 60 local farms and vendors with fruit, veggies, cheeses, meats, herbal wellness, and ready-to-eat food in a safe, fun outdoor space. We're happy to welcome back live music each week from 11 to 1 and our Pop Bucks program for kids. The market accepts Snap and offers Double Up and Fresh Connect. Stop by the market booth to find out about our new Solidarity Dollars. That's the Kingston Farmers Market in the County Courthouse parking lot. Uptown, Saturdays, 9 to 2, rain or shine. Find out more about our events and programs on Facebook and Instagram or at KingstonFarmersMarket.org.
You're listening to The Long Way Around. I'm your host, Malcolm Byrne, and I have as my special guest on tonight's program, esteemed author, political scientist, and card-carrying historian, Adolf Reed Jr.
Thanks, I appreciate that a lot.
I picked that up somewhere listening to your son, Touré, or you talking about Touré, I should say. Before we play some music, I just wanted to ask you about an occurrence, because I know you've gotten yourself into some hot water with your views, because they don't generally seem to conform with a lot of the current, I don't know what kind of thinking you'd call it, but is it true that you were canceled from a talk at Bard College?
Oh, no, it wasn't Bard. It was a DSA event, a program, a couple of years ago, right, in the first few months of the pandemic. And what happened was that that some friends of mine in the New York City DSA branch, along with some friends in the Philly DSA branch, and the friends in the New York DSA branch, or the key person who tried to organize or who organized this, in the New York DSA branch had moved up there from Philly. So, and the Philly DSA chapter was probably the most working class oriented and most sort of conventionally Marxist in the country. So it was luck, I guess. But they got the idea of wanting to sponsor a discussion with me about prompted by an article that I did in Common Dreams, and then a follow up that my colleague Marlon Chalkwanyan, who's a public health professor at Columbia, and I did in the New England Journal of Medicine, raising some red flags about the ease with which people were pointing to racial disparities in the incidence of COVID, death from COVID, and vulnerability to COVID. And what happened was, like, as the date of the event approached, first in the week before, as I understand it, a random guy in the New York chapter on his own, New Reconnaissance, took down all of the announcements of the event on the DSA platforms or chapter platforms, which was no big deal. A couple hundred people had signed up for it already. Anyway, it was going to be a Zoom thing. But then the morning of the event, a couple of hours before it was supposed to happen, a group that called itself the Afro-Socialist and BIPOC, Black, Indigenous, and People of Color Caucus in the DSA chapter, demanded that the event be terminated and be recast as, rather than Merlin and me having a discussion with people in the chapter, or with whoever, I guess, but that it be redesigned as a debate between what they characterized as my class reductionist views and their Afro-socialist or whatever the hell they were views. So we talked about this with the, Merlin and I decided, and mind you, this was still like in the early days of Zoom, and Zoom bombing and stuff was happening too. And we decided, frankly, you know, life was too short, right, to put up with this kind of foolishness. And we didn't want to, and the stress of being concerned that somebody would try to disrupt this thing just seemed not worth the effort. And our hosts were very gracious and understanding, though they did try to assure us that, you know, they could control it. But I said, nah. So, no, I wasn't. Well, and here's what I think is pretty disingenuous, because this was like one of two moments in my life when I had like a minute of Twitter infamy. And I didn't know about this one, right? But I heard about it later. But what people were complaining about was that that I hadn't been canceled, right? That I terminated the event myself, which I did, which I never denied, and it hastened to make clear to anybody, like including Michael Powell from the New York Times, who contacted me to write an article about the incident because he was prompted by you know, the man bites dog quality of it. But I never said otherwise. But what's disingenuous about it is that they did, in fact, demand that the event as organized be canceled, and that it should be replaced with another event, which I had no interest in participating in. I didn't want, I had no interest in debating, with the equivalent of a bunch of young holy rollers, and PMC, I mean, holy rollers, right? Professional managerial class, but well, I mean, holy rollers at that. You know, to have them yell at me for an hour, hour and a half, and like to use me as a knife sharpener for, I mean, display of their political righteousness. But I mean, not only that, but I mean, not only would it have been that kind of event, but the construct that, you know, that they wanted to organize it around was the equivalent of an "Are you still beating your wife?" question, right? Because they wanted this to be a debate between what they characterized as my putatively class reductionist views versus their good views. So I mean, that's what happened. Some people thought it was like striking that you know, this is like that somebody, I guess, with a history or a reputation for being a leftist of the sort that I've been all my life, gets attacked by a self-styled left caucus within DSA. But see, from my perspective, like the missing ingredient for an explanation is that these people aren't left, right? I mean, I've taken to calling this politics that you couldn't figure out what to characterize. I can't either. And I've taken to describing it as whatever that thing is that occupies the cultural space that a left would occupy in the U.S. if there were one.
Right. If there was one, that's the operative one.
Right. Yeah. But there's not. So that's what that thing was.
Yeah. I mean, we could probably talk all night about, you know, because I have my own issues with a lot of this current thinking, mm-hmm. in the sense that, I mean, I'll just be brief about it. But when Bernie Sanders was running in 2016, I was quite supportive of Bernie, and I ended up actually going down to the Democratic National Convention.
in
Philadelphia, yeah. that year, and I was representing an organization called Open Primaries.
You know, mm-hmm.
The idea was to kind of, you know, get rid of some of these antiquated, you know, primary voting rules like they have in New York, where, you know, you have to register as a Democrat 6 months before the primary in order to vote in the primary, which really is quite exclusive. You know, it excludes a lot of people because, you know, for people who had never heard of Bernie Sanders, especially younger students and so forth, that I talked to, you know, they're like, well, I'd love to vote for Bernie, but I can't, you know.
Right.
Or when I told them they couldn't, they were very disappointed. So I was, myself and my other individual went down there with a petition. I think we gathered about 40,000 names or 42,000 names to present to the Rules Committee. Mm-hmm. And one of the things that I became acutely aware of was the profound influence that the Congressional Black Caucus had over the proceedings. Everything had to sort of pass muster. And it felt to me, and perhaps you could correct me if I'm wrong, but it felt to me that there was this sense that, we, you know, all of these gains that we've, you know, since the Voting Rights Act and so forth, mm-hmm. we're not going to let go of any little bit of that power, you know, like what we've gained. Mm-hmm. There was no sense of moving the thing forward any further.
Yeah, okay.
Do you know what I mean?
Yeah.
And it felt like and then sort of between that and then the rise of the BLM movement, it felt like what originally started as a more of a economic equality movement had been, you know, the old divide and conquer routine had been used once again.
Yeah. Well, no, I think that's right. And I mean, I think too so the Congressional Black Caucus, I think there's a layered thing going on there, right? The Congressional Black Caucus, well, if you go back to the emergence of Clintonism at the end of the 80s and into the Clinton administration, right? You know, that was the triumph of a tendency that wanted to pull the Democratic Party to the right, right? Matt Groening has this great cartoon, like the punchline of which is like by, we can beat the Republicans by being more like the Republicans.
Right.
Right.
I mean, I was around in those days and I remember that the feeling, you know, right. Like if we're going to beat them, you know, we're going to become even more like them than they are, right. You know?
Yeah, that's right. Right. And I mean, this was kind of orchestrated, right, by the corporate interests that wanted to pull the Democratic Party to the right. And what we think of as neoliberalism, right? I mean, the combination of the retreat from a public good, understanding of the purpose of government, and the thrust of public policy to encourage upward redistribution instead of downward. Reagan opened the door and Clinton finished building the house, basically, right? And that's been the dominant tendency within the Democratic Party ever since then. And that's one reason that the right has been gaining ground with the working class, right? Of whatever color. But
I think it's not unreasonable to say that, you know, I might get strung up and run out of town for saying this, but the Democratic Party, in my eyes, is completely out of touch with the working classes.
Oh yeah, totally.
Like
totally,
it's become the party of the coastal elites.
Right.
And
it's absolutely correct. Yeah, it's absolutely correct. And Wall Street, right?
And Wall Street, of course, important. Naturally.
Right. Yeah. And they've been talking about this off and on for a while now. That you know, if they can imagine putting together a coalition that's racial minorities and women, as they understand the concerns of women, upper status women, basically, Wall Street, that they can still hope to win. I mean, but that was the story of 2016. In Philadelphia, right? I mean, you know, we're a battleground state. I guess it's not too late to say this now about 2020, but for about a month after the dust settled and Biden was declared winner in 2020, like I would say, when I talk to people, when I'm outside Southeast Pennsylvania, you're welcome, right? Because we basically turned it out for Biden. And I'm hoping now that Pennsylvania is going to help keep the Senate, right, with Fetterman. But the Clinton campaign, the last month and a half, had played two ads over and over and over, like every day. One of them was, you know, the grab him by the pussy ad.
Right.
And the other one was an ad that featured this very serious, sober, looking woman, middle-aged. She gave off all the symbols of suburban Philadelphia propriety. And she began the commercial by saying, "I'm a Republican, but my son has autism, and there's no place for my son in Donald Trump's America." And I'd watch these ads and think, really? Like, you got what? Like, you think this is going to win Pennsylvania for you? And only after the race did I learn that both Rendell and Schumer had boasted when during the race that for every blue collar vote that they lost in Western Pennsylvania, they'd pick up two from the Republican Philadelphia suburbs. And this has been the magical non-existent constituency that the National Democratic Party has been pursuing for 20 years, and it's not there, and it's never been there. But it's important for them to believe that it's there, because that's what justifies their absolute persistent the refusal to support anything that would transfer resources to working people, mm-hmm. right? So anyway, the Congressional Black Caucus, it's not, I mean, you're right. Like what they say to themselves, I'm sure, is that we have clawed our way to amass the kind of institutional power that we have, and we don't want any kind of reform that would jeopardize. But what they don't say as much, or at least not as publicly, is that they're completely in bed with the neoliberal program too.
Well, I mean, it was blindingly obvious to me.
Yeah. Oh, God, at the convention, definitely. Yeah. And the irony here is that where Clintonism consolidated initially by beating up on poor black people as scapegoats, right, with the welfare reform and the crime bills. At this point, the kind of performative anti-racism is the club, and you saw it in 2016 against Sanders, they did it again in 2020, the club that they used to beat back the left and to beat back the working class. So that, but by after the 2016 election, black talking heads and the punditry had even gotten to the point where they contended that even making a reference to the working class is a veiled cover to placate white racists, which means, among other things, that black and brown people can't be part of the working class then. Right.
As I said, when I was, you know, doing my bit for Bernie, you know, we were working out of an office here, a little office here in Kingston, that was a shared office with the Citizen Action, it's called.
Oh yeah. Mm-hmm.
And I was in the office and I was talking about something or other, and a black woman said to me, Bernie Sanders doesn't know anything about, he has nothing to do with me or our people. And he's just,
yeah.
You know, it was a real condemnation of,
right.
of Bernie.
Right.
And I really felt like I didn't have, I mean, I wasn't going to argue with her because
she's probably a Clinton functionary. Like I worked in a campaign both times, and I would get from various black people questions about why Bernie doesn't want to reach out to black people's issues. And my response was always the same. I would just go down the program item by item and say, okay, well, isn't that? And
how does Medicare for All not address?
Right. Right.
You know.
And I'm not exaggerating this, or at least I don't think I am, but I can't recall one encounter like that I had with working black people that didn't end with my interlocutor saying, oh, yeah, I see what you mean. I can't recall one encounter that I had with professional class black people that did go that way, right? Because they were never satisfied with that answer. And that's because what we think of, and my son's been making this point too, he tried to make it within the campaign too in 2020, that what we think of as black politics, in brackets, is a class politics, right? And I think that's becoming more and more obvious on a daily basis. I was just on a Zoom part of a Zoom event at what until 3 weeks ago was Ryerson University in Toronto. They changed the name now to Toronto Metropolitan. And I made this point the point lost me. It's going to come back in a second. Oh yeah, that what we think of as the Black agenda now, right? The centerpiece is the so-called racial wealth gap and narrowing the racial wealth gap. Now, how getting from the murder of George Floyd to narrowing the racial wealth gap happens, I don't know. But that's what's happened. Well, now as people have analyzed the data more, turns out 75% of so-called Black wealth, which is a foolish notion anyway, because it's owned by individuals, is held by the richest 10% of Black people. And 75% of so-called white wealth is held by the richest 10% of white people. So the rich and the bottom half of Black and white people have no wealth, period. So combating the racial wealth gap could not be more clearly a class agenda, mm-hmm. right? It's a monster of racial trickle down, and people don't want to hear that, and they cover their ears and scream loudly. Well, but the other thing about it tends to
sort of short circuit, because there's been such an emphasis, you know,
right?
You know, that it's almost like one of those Star Trek episodes where or something, mm-hmm. you know. Or in Twilight Zone or something like that.
Twilight Zone, I think, definitely gets it. And it's because, like, a key for making that thing work or making the ideology work is the notion that black people have a hive mind. Right, or Hispanic people have a hive mind, or women have a hive mind. Like they all want,
or white
same
people
thing.
For that matter.
Yeah, yeah. Well, no, totally. Yeah, yeah. I mean, that's what the white racists depend on, right? Right. I mean, like the idea. So, Dr. Oz is a Republican candidate for the Senate in Pennsylvania.
I heard that.
Right, and he's trying to run as a man of the damn people. And I just saw a photo of him a couple of days ago.
As a Republican?
Yeah. Really? With a campaign photo with him sitting with some guy like in a plow or a tractor or something. And his $75,000 SUV is parked right, I'm just on the other side of the street. But in his bill of particulars, establishing his bona fides as a man of the people, he actually said that he was a talk show host. So that's one of his qualifications to present himself as a man of the people, right?
I guess if a reality TV show star can get away with it, a talk show host can do it too.
Yeah, I know, man. But it's maddening. But that's exactly the thing that we have to break down. So that's the reason that some people yell at me sometimes.
Well, I don't know if I'll play the Soul Junction because that's 15 minutes long.
Oh yeah, right.
But what? Just for a laugh, let's play. Where is he? Hang on. I was going to play the Ernie Cato track.
Oh, yeah,
track.
Goodness. Yeah.
I'll play Here Come the Girls, and then we'll go to a commercial break, and then we'll come back. Is that cool?
Right.
All right. I don't know if you can see these flashing lights on my face.
Yeah, yeah. I was just going to ask you what's going on.
Well, it's not typically the light show that we have in the radio station. There's actually like an ambulance and a fire truck.
I thought it may have been that.
People standing outside, but anyway. Ernie Cato, Here Come the Girls.
It's a doggone shame that they couldn't all be mine. Looking so pretty, it's a doggone pity. Oh, looking so fine. Look out, brother, let me get brother a little closer to the one I love. Anything better than the opposite sex, they must have kept it up above.
These messages, stay tuned.
Hi, I'm Ursula Ingham, president of the Kingston Library Board of Trustees. Our Board of Trustees is made up of 9 residents of the city of Kingston who are elected to oversee library policy, budgeting, and the general direction of the library. Our library mission is to be a vital center in our diverse community. That our library inspires lifelong learning and empowers our citizens by providing free and equal access to information, ideas, books, and technology. Trustees are the connection to the community the Kingston Library serves. And while they don't work in the library, their diverse interests and skills have a meaningful impact on how the library is run. If you think your personal skills, abilities, and interests line up with the support of library services in Kingston, please consider running for a seat on the Kingston Library Board of Trustees in September. You can find Board of Trustees contact information when you click the About tab at kingstonlibrary.org.
Radio Kingston, many voices.
Many voices.
Many voices. One community.
Hi, everybody. Warren in the Morning here. Join me every Monday through Friday from 6 a.m. till 10 a.m. as we begin the day together right here on Radio Kingston. I've got the best music, trivia contests, local and national news, Dan along with the latest sports, and many surprise guests as well to keep you informed and entertained. See you every weekday morning starting at 6 right here on AM 1490, FM 107.9, and anytime at RadioKingston.org.
From our studio in Midtown, this is Radio Kingston, WKNY, AM 1490, FM 107.9, Kingston, New York.
Welcome to The Long Way Round. We're just kind of heading towards the second hour of the show, and my guest tonight is author, political scientist, and scientist, singular, Adolf L. Reed Jr., and I'm also going to give your book another plug, Adolf. Your new book, The South, Jim Crow and Its Afterlives. It's a fascinating read. Some people don't even know what Jim Crow is or was. I mean,
right.
Jim Crow is a character, right?
Right, yeah. And it's a name that was attached to the regime of codified racial hierarchy and explicit white supremacy that was installed in one southern state after another at the end of the 19th century after the defeat of the populist insurgency, which was largely biracial or was biracial or interracial enough for the ruling class to have had enough of it. And after that was suppressed, the next move was massive disfranchisement. The vast majority of blacks were disfranchised, depending on the state you were in, between 1890 and 1910. But in many states, up to or more than a quarter of white voters were disfranchised, too. Once the disfranchisement regime was successful, then that meant the center of gravity in state politics tilted very, very sharply to upper class interests, and an imposition of white supremacy by law, which basically gave any white person a higher status, before the law and in civic life than any black person, was kind of the consolation prize for working and lower class whites. But it enabled, so there are connections that people often don't think to make, right? For instance, everybody knows that the South is anti-union. But the South is anti-union because Southern governments during the first half to two-thirds of the 20th century were geared almost exclusively to reflect the interests of the upper classes. So where in states like Michigan and New York and the state of Illinois and elsewhere, where working people voted and trade unions were active in politics, the center of gravity of state level politics and then eventually of the federal government was much more worker friendly, right? Because politicians had incentives to be. That didn't happen in the South. So the other thing about this system is that it was historically specific, right? It was, as my comments suggest, it was a response to a particular problem at a particular moment that the Southern planter, capitalist, merchant class confronted, and was a problem of challenge from below by a mobilized alliance of black and white farmers and workers, basically. Once they resolved that challenge and consolidated the regime, I would often point out to students that all four of my grandparents were fully sentient, if not adults, by the time that the Jim Crow order was consolidated. And the back of the regime was broken by the time I was 18. I turned 18 in 1965. That's when the Voting Rights Act was passed, right? So it was a finite moment in American political history and in Southern political history. And, black people never stopped challenging it.
You mentioned in the book that, or perhaps was in an interview, that while that was going on, there wasn't a sense that that would end at some point.
Oh yeah, right. I know. Yeah, my good friend and former doctor, in the early 2000s, gave a talk at the NYU Med School, which was right down the street from my office then. And I went, it was in a snowstorm too, but anyway. And an earnest young woman, med student, lamented that she couldn't imagine. And my doctor friend was one of the founders of Physicians for a National Health Program, and that's what he was talking about, single payer on the Canadian model. And the woman says that the right wing had been in power all of her conscious life, and she couldn't imagine winning anything. And Quentin said to her, well, sometimes, there are good things about being old. And one of them is, I can tell you that nobody standing as late as 1950 would have imagined that that order was going to be crushed within 15 years. Mm-hmm. But it basically was, right? And this kind of to advert back to our earlier discussion before the break about what's understood to be black politics now. It's bizarre to me. It's genuinely bizarre to me to find that we find ourselves at a moment at which what's supposed to be the most radical stance is the one that says nothing has ever changed or can ever change, right?
I'm glad you brought up that subject because I was skirting.
It's insane. I mean, so how do you think that that's so? So where's the good in that, right? I mean, and that just underscores, and I see more and more evidence of this every time I look around, practically, the extent to which what this thing is that occupies the cultural space that a left would occupy is not really about a progressive politics at all, right? It's performative. It's entrepreneurial. But it's not at all about trying to build the kinds of broad alliances that we need to change the society in the ways we need to change it to make it better for everybody here. And to that extent, it's like the handmaiden of neoliberalism, right? I mean, it's no accident that Jeff Bezos and people like that started pouring money on Black Lives Matter after George Floyd was killed. Mm-hmm. Right? I mean, Bezos gave Van Jones, the civil rights activist, $100 million to go make racial justice. And I mean, the Black Lives Matter people, same kind of thing.
Like meanwhile, he fought tooth and nail against Chris Smalls.
Right. No, that's exactly right. Right. That's exactly right.
Which to me, Chris Smalls and that, however significant or insignificant that specific event was, to me that, I mean, again, for people who don't know what I'm talking about, the unionization, the labor organization that occurred with the Staten Island Amazon warehouse.
Right. Yeah. Right. Well, I tell you what else on that point, man. And I've been seeing more and more of this too. Corporate HR departments are making their diversity, equity, and inclusion programs are mobilizing them as part of their anti-unionization efforts. And it makes sense. It's only natural, right? Because it's an HR issue and it's HR approach to work, right? And into labor management.
Yeah, I started, a couple of years ago, I was actually down in New Orleans and my daughter, she's very motivated and but she had bought this book by this woman, Robin DiAngelo.
Oh, Lord, yeah.
And, bless her heart. She said, you might want to have a look at this. So I started reading it, and I didn't know anything about it at all. Mm-hmm. But within probably like the first two chapters, I had to put it down.
Yeah.
And I felt like I don't see the progress in this. I don't see where this could possibly lead to anything other than a woman getting paid $5,000 to lecture upper class white people why they're always going to be racist because they're white.
Well, yeah, I mean, I think you just found the golden Easter egg, right? I think that's what the story is. And I've been saying this for decades now. I just do not understand how we can expect to generate the broad solidarities that we need to win anything if we insist on beginning by going around the room to establish what we don't have in common, right? It just makes no sense to me. It makes no sense to me whatsoever. But it's not the point, right? Right. I mean, the point is what you said the point is.
Yeah. Anyway, I think we both know what the answer should be, you know, but it seems like it's, I mean, I just hope there isn't like a significant backlash, like another sort of Trumpist kind of.
Well, look, man, I published an article about a year ago, the title of which was "The Whole Country is a Reichstag." And I mean, I think that we are, and that's an allusion to the Nazis' burning of the Reichstag right after Hitler was named chancellor to give them an excuse to impose a dictatorship. Mm. And, you know, I think that the possibility of authoritarian takeover, right, either with the fig leaf of constitutional coup or directly, is very serious at this point. And I think the January 6th hearings have been making that clearer. But when you see how the Supreme Court is implicated in it, and I don't know if we're going to survive. And I can say that if the Democrats don't hold on to at least one house of Congress in November, then the Republicans are just going to run out the clock until 2024 and then take over. Right? I mean, they would certainly vote. You bring impeachment charges against Biden. The Senate, if the Republicans control it, would almost certainly vote to impeach him, put him out of office, and I think they've got their excuse.
Well, on that cheerful note, Adolf.
Yeah.
What I want to segue. I want to play some music, and I wanted to go back a little bit into your upbringing and talk about how music. For me personally, music has always been something that brings people together for the most part, you know. So I'd like to hear your feelings, growing up with, because, you know, while all of these things were going on with Jim Crow and segregation, separate, not equal, at the same time, there was, you know, young people were getting into, white kids were getting into black music and God knows all this.
Well, I mean, I'll tell you, quite specifically, when I was a little kid, right, I listened to music. I liked the Mills Brothers and Johnny Ray, and then Elvis and me came around. But I remember my father's parents lived in Dumas, Arkansas, which is where my dad was born. And there's a guy who my grandfather would go fishing and duck hunting with, named Dewey, mm-hmm. who had a little tavern like a couple of houses away from theirs called Dewey's Tavern. And my father would go over there and drink beer and talk with the guys. And I would go over and eat hamburgers. And place had an old piccolo, right, in a jukebox with like six plays for a quarter when I was little.
I love jukeboxes.
And I started hearing sounds come out of it like I'd never imagined before. It was like blues, right? People like Nappy Brown and, you know, B.B. King and the Howling Wolf. And I was just like mesmerized by it. So I started begging Porters to play it. And then in New Orleans, there was a place, it was probably still around, like we were down there. Mule's in the 7th Ward on...
That was around when
Germany and the Harp, right?
Mm-hmm. Yep.
Right, about a half block from John Boutte's family's house. And they had the best hot sausage po' boys in the city. And Fats Domino, well, yeah, I'm sure you know the story that, you know, when Fats was just getting started, Mule helped bankroll him or helped him in some way. And when I was in high school, you know, Fats was at his height. And whenever he was in town, his baby pink and baby blue Eldorado was parked outside. Yeah, outside the bar, whether Fats was inside or not. And like all his hits were on a jukebox. But we had the same thing. Like my mother would send my father and me to go get hot sausage poor boys from Ulay's. My dad would sit at the bar and drink a couple goblets of draft beer. Yeah, and I'd play the jukebox. And it was the same kind of thing. So like this is how I discovered people. I remember I was listening to the radio in the ninth grade, and the two black oriented AM stations were WYLD and WBOK. YLD. So a few years earlier, like my dad was a big jazz aficionado, mainly big band guy. And he kind of made me watch the old Timex jazz shows. There were like a year or two when on CBS, I'm pretty sure, Timex sponsored live jazz performances. So that just got my ear, got my ear attuned to jazz. But so YLD had a late night jazz show from something like 11 to 2. And then from 2 to 5, or maybe 11 to 1, and from 2 to 5 on Saturday, I believe. And so I stay up to listen to the jazz show, but also like R&B, man. But you're living in New Orleans in the early '60s, and you don't really know that you're in the middle of like this extraordinary moment in black music, right? I mean, Aaron Neville, right? You mentioned Aaron. Aaron would like a couple times stopped up at my high school after basketball practice to play pickup basketball with us. Right.
Good
But the Royal Dukes of Rhythm played our high school dances, and Joe Tex would make a cameo, right? Or Aaron would make a cameo. And it just seemed like normal life, right? But anyway, like I remember particular mesmerizing moments were Aretha Franklin's Yesterday I Sang the Blues. That's the first time I'd heard her. And I was like 12 or 13, and I heard that song on the radio. I thought, oh my God, what is this? Right? There was that. Johnny Adams is fighting a losing battle. And Ray Charles. And it just kind of opened up. So before the CD era, when I spent a lot of time driving on the highway, I still got them. I hope that they're still good. I made 13 or 14 90-minute tapes of what I described as the best of jukebox hits from these four bars in the city that I hung out when I was in high school.
Did you ever go to the Saturn Bar? Remember the Saturn?
Oh, yeah. Yes. In fact, I had a friend who lives a couple blocks from the Saturn Bar now.
Because they used to have a great jukebox that...
They did.
I had a few clients that I worked with. You know, I used to have a studio down there, and people would go up to the Saturn Bar and play. I love that jukebox.
Oh, man. That's fabulous. Well, and it's still going. I haven't been in there in a while, but it's still operating.
It's under new ownership, luckily.
Oh, is it?
Yeah, some younger people. But I'm going to segue this into some Lou Donaldson.
Oh, lovely. That's great.
So we're going to chill, kick back and relax to Lou Donaldson's Autumn Nocturne here. Thank you. Reed Jr. right after these messages. Stay tuned.
Hi, I'm Emily Flynn from Bike Friendly Kingston. We're happy to announce monthly slow rides this summer. Slow rides are guided group rides meant for all abilities done at a slow pace. They're a great way to explore Kingston neighborhoods and gain confidence riding a bicycle. We're riding together on the first Thursday of every month at 6 p.m. through October. They start at the parking lot at the YMCA of Kingston and Ulster at 507 Broadway. When you ride with us, you should wear a helmet, have front and rear lights, bring water, and wear comfortable clothing. Route lengths vary from 5 to 20 miles and are hosted by different bicycle leaders. Bike Friendly Kingston Slow Rides, first Thursdays at 6 p.m. at the YMCA. For more information, including cancellations and updates, check out Bike Friendly Kingston's events on Facebook.
Hi, I'm Kevin Godby.
And I'm Veronica Fossbender, and we're your hosts of Kingston Happenings, Monday nights at 9 p.m. here on Radio Kingston.
Each week, we'll be helping our community stay informed about upcoming events, new businesses, community initiatives, and more.
Plus, you'll get to hear some great local music.
It's the radio extension of our website that tells you about everything that's going on in the Kingston area, kingstonhappenings.org.
We'll be talking with local organizations, business owners, and chat with movers, shakers, doers, and dreamers, those who are making things happen in the community.
So tune into Kingston Happenings, Monday nights at 9 p.m.
Here on Radio Kingston, AM 1490, FM 1079, and anytime at radiokingston.org.
And in celebration of Pride 2022, the Rosendale Theater is hosting a screening of The Adventures of Priscilla, Queen of the Desert, followed by a dance party Friday, June 24th. This Academy Award-winning comedy film features Terrence Stamp, Hugo Weaving, and Guy Pearce, and follows three Australian showgirls, two drag queens, and a transgender woman as they drive through the outback in their battered pink tour bus in order to get to their dream gig. This film is rated R and may not be suitable for all ages. After the movie, there'll be a dance party on the theater's new dance floor. Guests are welcome to arrive just in time for the dance party at 9 p.m. Tickets are $20 for the movie and dance party and $10 for the dance, with discounts for theater members. The Adventures of Priscilla, Queen of the Desert, and Pride Dance Party, Friday, June 24th, 7 p.m. for the film and 9 p.m. for the dance party at the Rosendale Theater, 408 Main Street in Rosendale. For tickets and information, go to rosendaletheater.org. That's rosendaletheater.org. Yes, indeed. Hi, Adolf.
Hey, good timing. But man, that was like such a beautiful song. And like Lou Donaldson is such a clear, clean tone.
Beautiful tone. You know, when I went, it wasn't the first time I'd been to New Orleans, but I'd mentioned that I went down there to work on, mm-hmm. on some albums with, because I'm, you know, my day job is a record producer, actually. And before I went down there, a friend of mine, a guy named Tom Wilson, he had a very good record collection. He used to do a DJ thing in a club up in Hamilton, mm-hmm. Ontario, where I lived. And I said, Tommy, I'm going down to New Orleans, and I want to hear as much music from New Orleans as I can possibly. So he made me, you mentioned cassettes. So he made me a 90-minute cassette. And, you know, it was everything on there. There was like, you know, Professor Longhair, Dr. John, and everybody. And I just immersed myself into that. And
that's great.
And one of the things that I found myself really getting an appreciation for once I lived there was, you know, I could just go down to Frenchman Street. There's, mm-hmm. you know, clubs down there. You could just listen to, there'd be some amazing, like, jazz players. Just go down a Tuesday afternoon and there'd be somebody playing, you know. So it
it's wonderful, man. It really is.
Solidified my appreciation for jazz music experience. But I noticed you have James Taylor on your list.
Oh, yeah. I like him generally, but there's a Carolina connection, right? Because he was a street musician in Chapel Hill when I was there.
Oh, is that right?
Yeah. So I used to see him out, you know, just playing on the corner, basically. But those two songs in particular, like I like that Flag album. I was listening to them on the way up, up here from Philly. But the Mill Worker song and Sleep Free Me are just kind of really powerful, poignant songs.
Well, this is the Mill Worker, James Taylor.
Oh, yeah, cool.
Now my grandfather was a sailor. He blew in off the water. My father was a farmer, and I, his only daughter, took up with a no-good mill-working man from Massachusetts, who dies from too much whiskey and leaves me these three faces to feed. Ain't easy. Mill work ain't hard. Mill work, it ain't nothing but an awful boring job. I'm waiting for a daydream to take me through the morning and put me in my coffee break where I can have a sandwich and remember. Then it's me and my machine for the rest of of the morning, for the rest of the afternoon, and the rest of my life. My mind begins to wander to the days back on the farm. I can see my father smiling at me, swinging on his arm. I can hear my granddad's stories of the storms out on Lake Erie, with vessels and cargoes and fortunes whose sailors' lives were lost. Yes, but it's my life has been wasted, and I have been the fool to let this manufacturer use my body for a tool. I can ride home in the evening, staring at my hands, swearing by my sorrow that a young girl ought to stand a better chance. I work the mills just as long as I am able, and never meet the man whose name is on the label. It'd be me and my machine for the rest of the morning, and the rest of the afternoon gone, for the rest of my life.
James Taylor, Mill Worker.
Yeah, thanks. I'm trying to decide whether it was more powerful when it came out in the mid-70s or now.
I would say probably in real terms, more powerful now.
Yeah, yeah, that's what I was wondering.
You know, about a month and a half or almost 2 months ago, I had my guest on the show was a really interesting... Well, I don't know if you're familiar with a guy named Lee Camp. He claims to be America's most censored comedian.
Oh, okay.
He was one of the number of individuals that was on RT America that got when they sort of shut down. He had a show on there called Redacted Tonight.
He's very
funny.
Yeah.
And anyway, his partner Eleanor Goldfield. Is quite an interesting person as well. And she had done a film sort of inadvertently. She'd accompanied a friend of hers out to West Virginia, and she ended up making a film. You know, she got out there and saw, you know, the plight of the people there, you know, that still have this kind of attachment to the mining companies. They have a loyalty to the company, even though it's the thing that's caused them the most harm, you know. And she talks about how the current way of mining coal now, they just, you know, in the old days they used to dig a hole in the ground and everybody would go down there and dig out the coal, but now they just take the top off the mountain, and that has a lot of ecological and health implications, you know.
Yep.
And, you know, I've had a couple of other guests on. Chris Hedges was on about a month ago.
Oh, yeah.
And, you know, what this recurring theme seems to come up, you know, and I know that you're thinking about it a lot, which is, you know, what's happened to the working classes in this country? You know, what does the future look like for them? You know, black, white, or otherwise, you know, it doesn't matter.
Yeah.
You know, we're trying to figure that out. So yeah, I think mill worker is very relevant today.
Yeah.
You know. Sorry, I didn't mean to go off on a tangent there on you, but
that's a good tangent. So I guess if it's a good tangent, it's technically not a tangent.
Yeah. I suppose. I was going to save, I thought I'd save Soul Junction for the last 15 minutes of the show.
Okay.
So
yeah,
we could sign off and just chill out and listen to that for the last 15 minutes.
That sounds good.
But in terms of you, where you're at, I mean, are you still teaching?
No, I retired in July of 2019. And it's kind of funny because I retired and then the campaign started picking up. So I worked first in the campaign. And then I left the campaign and went to work in a parallel effort called the Medicare for All South Carolina Voter Project that our 501c3, the Deb Jones Douglas Institute, ran. So that put a firewall between me and the campaign. But so I was doing that until after the South Carolina primary, and then the pandemic hit. So it's like I never really got to prepare for proper kind of retirement. So, but this summer I'm starting a second week now of this summer summer school, really, that this that a unit at Cornell called the School of Criticism and Theory does every summer, and I'm doing a 6-week seminar here in Ithaca called Beyond the Race Class Dichotomy. And the 14, 15 people who are enrolled are all PhD students, pretty much. There's one person who is an MA student and one person who's actually a professor at places around the country, some of them outside the U.S. So we finished the first week, and it's been good so far. I gotta be ready to meet him at 9:30 tomorrow morning, and then I've got to give a public lecture at 3:30 tomorrow afternoon. But that's why I'm here in Tompkins County for the next 6 weeks.
Okay, that's not.
Yeah, it's funny. Like this is, I think, my 7th time in Ithaca. Once was in October, I believe.
It's a beautiful area.
Every other time has been between Thanksgiving and the end of February, which is exactly when you don't want to be in Ithaca.
I was just about to say that. Now you're now you're there,
And this is what people have always said to me. Oh, you should be here in the summer. Yeah. And yeah, that's right. It's absolutely beautiful here.
So what do you think the what do you think the corrective course is in the narrative that we're currently having in terms of race and
okay. Well, that's a really good question. There are a number of things. And this is like a cornerstone of this course I'm doing too, but I've been arguing for a while that race is one of a set. It's one particular version of a class of ideologies, right? That are basically just so stories that divide or that carve populations up into categories that are then treated as groups. Characteristics and aspirations and attributes are ascribed to them, right? And they function as a sort of common sense, as just so stories. Mm-hmm. And what they do is in any kind of hierarchical society, but race in particular, it is a product of capitalism, as as that one kind of hierarchical society, is that they provide a narrative that explains why or and justifies why everybody is in the place where they need to be or where they're supposed to be in the natural order of things, right? So what these ideologies do is they read existing social hierarchies that are rooted in class and political economic dynamics, read them into nature, right? Mm-hmm. I mean, this is, you know, this is much older than race, right? You think of things like the divine right of kings. Well, who came up with that? But with the kings and the priests that the kings fed came up with the divine right of kings, right? So I think it's helpful to see race as not as a sui generis, conversation-stopping, horrible system of oppression, but as one of a number of variants of ideology that do that kind of work in different societies at different points in time. Right. I mean, I tend to go for the taxonomies associated with an evolutionary metaphor. And from that perspective, I think race is a species of the genus, and the genus is the broader category that includes gender, a bunch of other stuff. In fact, I just read a paper by a colleague of mine here in this program. It's a really interesting study of post-World War II Germany and struggles over whether people who had been exterminated because of their cognitive or physical disabilities should have the same status with respect to demanding criminal justice, basically, as people who were killed because of their race. And I found it chilling to find out that this had been an ongoing controversy for decades, because it never occurred to me that they were anything different, right? But it was also pretty clear to me, and my colleague agreed, that what was especially chilling about it was that those who were invested as seeing the victims of exterminism on the basis of cognitive or physical disability as being qualitatively different from exterminism on the basis of race, it were people who are still committed to the idea that the cognitively and physically disabled were a lesser population. And I don't know, right? I mean, maybe under the right circumstances, could be gotten rid of, right? See what I mean? So, and one of the things that happens when we treat race as a conversation-stopping horror, right, is that you miss a lot of other stuff that's parallel. Like, here's one that I think you'll appreciate in particular because it's got a New Orleans twist to it. Last summer, I think it was, I went to see a film that was part of the New Orleans Film Festival. It was a documentary on the Vietnamese American community, out in New Orleans East in mm-hmm. Versailles.
Yeah.
And my niece was in it, right? So documentary was fine, but at the beginning there's like a video land acknowledgement statement, right? And over a photo of a ship at a night turning around in the river, the narrator reads a list of like every identified Native American group that had ever lived in a parish. The African slaves and the burial grounds, right, and so forth and so on. And I mentioned it to my son the next morning, and the first question out of his mouth was also the thing I've been waiting for to hear, which is that upwards of 20,000 Irish immigrants died and were buried in digging the New Basin Canal that connected the lake to downtown in the 1830s. And he asked me, so was there any reference to the Irish immigrants? And no, of course there wasn't, right? So
probably no reference to the Sicilian cane workers either.
Oh, well, no, that's right. That's exactly right. Yeah, it's exactly right. It's the same thing, right? So, I mean, how is this? And I mean, it's such a bamboozlement, right? Well, with the idea that we get sold, that our oppressions are unique and discreet. Like, I'll give you another story, right? My good friend and comrade, Mark Dudzik, who for a while put out the DC Labor Film Festival. And a few years ago, they showed the John Sayles film, Mate One.
Oh, yes. It's one of my favorite films.
Yeah. And Sayles was there, right? And he answered questions afterward. And a young woman who was a staffer of some union, white woman, Ernest, asked Sayles why he invented this fiction of the black workers and the, I forget what the white workers were they Polish?
It's been 20 years or more I forget.
But the black and white workers aligned. And when she said everybody knows that the white workers or those white ethnic workers hated the black workers. And Sayles said to her, well, yeah, I'm sorry, but that's what happened. Right? I mean, right, this guy came up from Alabama. He'd been involved, a black guy. He'd been involved in some union activity down there. And he gets up there and he finds out that the black workers have been brought in as strike breakers, and they organized with the white workers. But like, this is not how we're supposed to think as progressives now, which means that the boss has moved inside our heads and is doing our thinking for us. Like 50 years ago when I was an organizer and people say stuff like that to me, I'd ask them, so which branch of the police are you working for? Like, are you the military police or civic or city police, FBI, or what are you? But now they don't need to pay them, right? They don't need to train them. It's the radicals themselves who are doing the boss's work for them.
Well, I think that's an excellent way to kind of wrap it up a little bit. I think that seems to be the issue at stake. And I guess the question is how to get that message out there without...
I tell you what, if you grant me a plug, so we have a podcast now called the Class Matters Podcast.org.
Okay.
And it's a project of the Debs Jones Douglas Institute. And we say that we're the place where you come to discuss what would the country, or the question, what would the country look like if we're governed by and for the working class? And it just seems to me like we'll make the headway that we need to make when we talk to working people about the concrete concerns: jobs, housing, healthcare, education, and build solidarities around those common shared concerns. And it's really only on the basis of solidarities built around common concerns like that that you can have any hope to fight the prejudices and the bigotry and stuff. Like, I often ask people who are committed or believe that they're committed, to opposition to abortion or same-sex marriage. I'll ask them, so, yeah, okay, but what's more important to you? Is it more important to you that no woman can ever have an abortion, or that no two people of the same sex can ever marry, or that you have a secure job and income, access to healthcare, right, and decent housing, right? And no, No, that's not asking people to convert, right? But the reality is that if there is going to be any conversion down the road, like it's going to be on the basis of having formed personal relationships with people who favor things that you think you oppose.
Hell yeah.
Cool. Well, hey, man, it's been great.
Yeah.
And thanks for having me on. I really appreciate it.
Yeah. And once again,
I'm going to... will it be available?
Pardon me?
When will the link be available?
Usually after the show, I go right home and I...
Oh, wow. Okay.
And it should be up there by later tonight or first thing in the morning.
Oh, okay. Yeah. Can you send me a link when it's up?
I'll definitely do that, yeah. And so another plug for the book, the latest book by Adolf Reed Jr. is called The South, Jim Crow and Its Afterlives. A very fascinating read. I'm looking forward to finishing the book. And we'll go out with Soul Junction. Talk about this track before we play it. I know John Coltrane's on there, Red Garland Quintet.
Yeah, and a very young Donald Byrd. And like this is another one of those things that I heard as a kid. So my dad was a huge Johnny Hodges fan, right? I mean, he would rather...
Do you know, a friend of mine named Garth Hudson. I don't know if that name's not familiar to you. He's one of the two living remaining members of the band.
Sorry.
Keyboard
player.
Wow, cool. It's okay.
Yeah.
He's the keyboard player and he's also a great horn player, and he always talks about Johnny Hodges.
Oh man, he's fabulous. Yeah, but he's the absolute greatest. And that's really what kind of looped me into jazz, right? I mean, him and Lester Young and I mean the Basie band, and then so I was like a kid of the hard bop era. I made the transition from the old Coltrane to the new stuff, and like after I whipped out that playlist, I started thinking about a bunch of stuff from late 60s and early 70s, like Max Roach and Gary Bartz. I got a buddy in Denver who's a few years my junior, but he's also a big I'm a jazz aficionado, and we often start the day comparing our playlists, right, for that day while we're working.
Great way to start the day. Well, look,
yeah, this is just a fabulous, fabulous, fabulous cut, man. And when Coltrane comes in eventually, because Garland's just beautiful right all the way through it, and when Bird comes in, it's almost transporting, right?
Well, thanks for spending the time, and I wish you well.
No, thanks for having me. I really appreciate it.
And I'd love to have you back sometime.
I'd love to do it.
Depending on what comes up next week, maybe I'll play the rest of this playlist. So I'll let you know.
No, do. Yeah, do let me know.
Okay. Take care of yourself. Thank you.
Yeah. Take care.
Bye. Thank you. for tuning in, and hope you've enjoyed the show with Adolf Reed Jr. Like I said, don't forget to check out his book and also the podcast that Adolf mentioned, Class Matters. ClassMattersPodcast.org. And if the good Lord's willing and the creek don't rise, we'll see you next week. And if you've enjoyed this program and all the others we bring to you, you can always go back and check them out on the archive at RadioKingston.org. A long way around. Stay tuned for Shiro's coming up right after this. Be well.